Vietnam, 1966. America's involvement in the war is rising. By year's end, the number of American troops in Vietnam would climb to 400,000. In February of that year, a lone vigilante reconnaissance jet climbed into the clear blue sky over the Gulf of Tonkin on a mission to photograph bombing targets in North Vietnam. One jet with one fighter escort heading in harm's way. Navy pilot Gerald Coffey and navigator Bob Hansen Jr. looked forward to a routine run followed by some promised R&R, rest and recreation, in Hong Kong. Coffey had no way of knowing his quick reconnaissance mission would last 7 years. Gerald Coffey was about to trade the freedom of flying for the confinement of a 3-foot by 6-foot North Vietnamese prison cell. But in that time, he would gain a deeper understanding of victory. Hello, I'm Steve Bell, and this is Victories, stories of triumph over adversity, celebrations of the human spirit. For Gerald Coffey, victory would come after 7 years in hell.
I never come to the city without coming to the wall. I always come and look at Bob's name, my crewman's name. I look at Bob's name and I see my reflection in this marble, and I recognize that but for a split second or a quarter of an inch somewhere along the way, it could just as well be me, my name, up there along with his.
That's the end of the story. Let's go back to the beginning. California native Jerry Coffey always loved the water, so it just seemed natural that his choice for military service would take him to the Florida shoreline.
Well, you know, Pensacola Beach, man, this is where it all started. Naval aviation looked exciting, and man, I like the looks of the beaches here at Pensacola. Pensacola Bay, man, that's the first time I got my parachute training. A bay a little bit like this is, I was first introduced to North Vietnam, as a matter of fact.
Jerry flew scores of missions long before he saw Vietnam. In 1962, his daring low-level reconnaissance flights helped uncover Soviet missile launchers in Cuba. Over his 28-year career, the Navy awarded him the Silver Star, Air Medal, Distinguished Flying Cross, and 2 Bronze Stars. So, it's no surprise the Navy sought Jerry's expertise in Vietnam.
You know, that really is a magnificent airplane. It's an incredible airplane. It was the Cadillac of naval aviation. It really was. It looks like it's going Mach 2, twice the speed of sound, while it's sitting right here on the deck.
Jerry and navigator Bob Hansen landed on board the aircraft carrier Kitty Hawk in January 1966. Most of their 22 missions over Vietnam and Laos were pretty uneventful. No reason to think February 3rd would be any different.
We taxied up to the catapult and went through all of our checks and got shot off into the blue and climbed out and headed for the beach. Somewhere in the process, about 4,000 feet of altitude, we took a hit. So I turned the aircraft back toward the Tonkin Gulf. The control stick froze in my hand stiff. I couldn't move it, and it became clear at that point that we couldn't stay with the airplane any longer.
Jerry regained control long enough for Bob and him to fire their ejection seats. The vigilante was still traveling 680 miles per hour when they exploded out of the cockpit.
By rights, neither one of us should have survived, but we both survived the ejection. And he was killed sometime in the battle that ensued for our capture.
Jerry didn't know that at the time. He kept trying to account for his buddy as his captors dragged him from the water and began a 12-day journey on foot and in the back of a rickety old truck all the way to Hanoi.
My entire body was sore. I'd been beaten by the crowds in small villages and hamlets along the way, so I was really kind of a mess when I got there. Finally, after traveling for about 12 days, no medical care, we reached the outskirts of Hanoi, and that early morning continued on right down to the very heart of Hanoi and pulled up in front of this huge, formidable-looking fortress of a prison called Hoa Lo, which in Vietnamese means fiery forge. We bounced through the big iron gate of Wallow and through an entry tunnel into a big center courtyard where several guards took me out of the vehicle and marched me around through corridors and down corridors and through arched doorways and so on, big stone building to my first cell.
The walls of Wallow Prison would become his home for the next 7 years. When Victories continues, the soaring pilot hits rock bottom. Welcome back to Victories. In February 1966, captured flyer Jerry Coffey felt a long way from Victory as his North Vietnamese guards threw him into his tiny cell inside Wallow Prison.
A huge, heavy wooden door slammed behind me. A big iron bolt clanked home in the lock outside, sort of a note of finality. And I think that's when it really hit me. I found myself in this filthy, tiny cell, high ceiling, a tiny yellow light bulb glowing very high, but not really giving much light. Filthy, greasy walls and a concrete slab for a bed. Ankle stocks at the foot of the slab, big, huge, heavy iron manacle that came down across the top of the ankle stocks and would lock with a big rusty padlock. A tiny window very high in the back wall with a double row of iron bars, and all I could see through the window were the shards of filthy broken glass embedded in the concrete on top of the 16-foot wall that surrounded the entire prison. And that cell just reeked of the human misery that had been there before me.
If the horrible physical conditions in the prison cell weren't bad enough, Jerry was making a mental prison for himself with all the emotions he was facing alone.
I felt guilty about losing my airplane, about losing my crewman, guilty about letting down my squadron mates, about letting my family down, guilty about not being as tough as I thought I would be as a prisoner of war, guilty about not being able to stick to the code of conduct, to give only my name, rank, serial number, and date of birth. That was probably the lowest point of the entire 7-year incarceration.
And there were some especially painful thoughts he had to endure. For instance, the realization he would not be there when his pregnant wife, Bee, delivered their fourth child. Ironically, the North Vietnamese could keep Jerry's mind off home at times with their frequent torture and interrogation. You could see it in the pictures they released, the flyer's friendly face reduced to a grim, haggard countenance. But in the midst of it all, a glimmer of hope.
As it turned out, early on, in the first few months, they moved us fairly frequently to keep us off balance. I was moved into a small cell, and some American who'd been in that little cell before me had scratched in the wall two words with an equal sign between them. And the little formula simply said, God equals strength. God equals strength. And I found that for me that really worked, because I was never, ever totally alone.
The days still dragged on. The interrogation sessions could be just as painful. The twice-a-day meals still meager.
But finally my prayers began to change, and I quit saying, why me, God? And I started saying, show me, God. Show me what this is for. Show me what I'm supposed to do with this. Help me to understand how I'm supposed to use this experience. Help me to use it to go home, whatever that might be, as a better, stronger, smarter person in every possible way that I can. To go home as a better naval officer, to go home as a better American, as a better citizen, a better husband and father, and a better friend to all my friends. God, please help me to use this time productively so that it isn't just a void or a vacuum in my life. And that was the turning point. The realization and the acceptance that there was indeed a purpose. I was supposed to learn something from this in ways that would allow me to use it for good in the future.